In the crucifixion narrative, we have the words spoken by Jesus from the cross, as recorded in the New Testament Gospels, and often referred to as the seven last words or seven sayings. The exact wording and order of these sayings vary slightly among the Gospels. Time does not permit me this Easter to deal with the whole seven. However, I have selected two, which I feel can be relevant to our lives today. From Matthew and Mark, we have the most chilling of cries, from Matthew 27:46. My God, why have you forsaken me? And Luke 23:46, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. They are intimate words addressed to his Father, and when looked at more closely, they have something to say to us today. While common sense dictates I should look at them in the order they come, I have, however, chosen to reverse the order and look at Luke this Good Friday, leaving Matthew to Resurrection Sunday. In his classic contemporary hymn, How Deep the Father's Love for Us, writer Stuart Townend recalls that the hymn was written to depict what it cost the Father to give the Son for our redemption. It speaks to our complicity in the crucifixion and the personal perspective which points towards Christ. Behold, the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders, ashamed. I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. At the point of death, Jesus utters seven words which, when understood, offer great comfort to everyone who has placed their trust in his redeeming death and resurrection. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Even though the anguish of the Garden of Gethsemane was draining and strenuous, now, in the darkest moment of his life, Jesus reaches out to his Father. While many of us will see life through to a good age, here is a young man in the prime of his life, whose life is about to be snatched from him in the most brutal and barbaric manner. It may well be that the last words of Jesus, the Son of the living God, have something meaningful to say to us. I suspect that we can get so immersed in the pathos and suffering of Good Friday that we can miss an important fact. In all the trauma and suffering of that first Good Friday comes an enduring message of power. Now the daylight flees, now the ground beneath quakes as its maker bows his head. Curtain torn in two, dead are raised to life. Finished, the victory cry. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath. We stand forgiven at the cross.
Oh, to see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten. The pain. Oh, to see the pain.
He commences with just one word, Father. No elaborate titles or descriptors, no superlative adjectives, just the word, Father. And in its simplicity, it is a powerful statement. Despite the circumstances that surround Jesus, there is one word that is his anchor, Father. It has been the mainstay and foundation of his ministry. Above everything else, Jesus taught the concept of God as Father around 165 times, making it one of the most important themes of his teaching. Perhaps more than anything else, Jesus wants us to fully understand this concept of a heavenly Father. The concept of God as Father was not widely present in the Old Testament, but became more prominent in the New Testament through Jesus' teachings. As he utters his final words, it is in the intimate relationship of a child to its father. It seems that all the forces of darkness are arrayed against him as Satan mounts his final, ineffectual battle. Despite all the suffering and abuse he has received, Jesus' relationship and trust in his Father is still firm and resolute. In the Gospels, Jesus taught that believers have a relationship with God as a heavenly Father. The Gospels contain some well-known passages in the New Testament that reinforce the concept of God as Father. In a prayer taught by Jesus to his followers in the Gospel of Matthew, he addresses God as our Father in what we now call the Lord's Prayer. This prayer illustrates believers' intimate relationship with God by addressing him as Father and trusting in his provision, forgiveness, and guidance. In Jesus' teachings, God is portrayed as an intimate Father involved in the lives of his children. Sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of care and bids me at my Father's throne make all my wants and wishes known.
Sweet. Oh.
The example of Jesus was, at the darkest hour of his life, he seeks the consolation of his Father. For most of us, there will come times when all the forces of darkness seem arrayed against us, where circumstances and environment can combine to destabilize our faith and trust in our Heavenly Father. That is part of our humanity, and we do well to acknowledge it and deal with it as best we can, secure in the knowledge that our Father is ever present. I believe that God understands that there are times when our faith and trust wavers. However, we need to, like Jesus, steel our spirit and affirm our absolute trust in our Heavenly Father, in spite of our vacillating feeling. Like the father who came to Jesus seeking healing for his child who cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe, help my unbelief." There is a sense in which, when we can fully embrace the magnitude of God as Father, it reinforces and strengthens our faith. Great Father of glory, pure Father of light, thine angels adore thee, all veiling their sight. All praise we would render, O help us to see, 'tis only the splendor of light hideth thee.
Thank you.
In Jesus' cry from the cross, it is obvious that he has absolute faith in his Father's care. Beyond death, he counted on God to be there for him. He surrendered, not as a sign of defeat, but as a sign of victory. It is our privilege as believers to be part of that security and this victory. As Jesus explains the Good Shepherd to his listeners in John 10, verses 11 to 12, he tells them, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one." Through his relationship with his Father, Jesus knew the reality of this security. Just as he promised his disciples that no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand, Jesus knew his life, despite all the trauma and suffering that surrounded him, could not be snatched from the Father's hand. In the face of hatred, betrayal, and abandonment, despite the cunning and duplicity of those who manipulated the crowd to bring about his crucifixion, despite the ignorance of those who had turned against him, his secure faith and trust in the love of his Father would triumph. Many along life's journey have experienced similar hatred, betrayal, and abandonment. And at such times, we, like Jesus, need to know that our lives cannot be snatched from the Father's hand. Committing one's spirit to God is not only a matter of resignation, it is a profound act of trust on the part of the person who makes the commitment. Regardless of the circumstances around us, the act reflects a deep-seated belief in God's goodness and faithfulness. This act serves as a beacon of hope in a world plagued by fear and uncertainty, assuring us that we are held securely in the hands of God. In reality, all too often, people seek security in material possessions, relationships, and accomplishments, only to find them unreliable and fleeting. There are, however, no limits to the security that God offers. Despite all the world's troubles, it remains steadfast, unwavering, and unfailing. In the same way that Jesus surrendered his spirit to the Father, we must trust in the unfailing love and providence of God for the whole of life. I'm in his hands. What are the future holds? I'm in his hands. The days I cannot see have all been planned for me. His way is best you see. I'm in his hands. Thank you. Jesus is very focused here. I commit my spirit. In committing his spirit to his Father, he wasn't entrusting the physical elements of his body. It was clear to him that his body would go where all deceased bodies go, to a tomb. It is probably difficult for many of us to truly grasp what we mean when we talk about our spirit and what it means to us. It is often described as a person's animating force or the driving force that drives them forward in life. It is a life force, the non-physical part that gives life, energy, and power to the body. Jesus' eternal spirit was surrendered to God at the cross, even though his body had ceased to function. As a result of the resurrection, the spirit and body of Jesus were reunited, whether consciously or unconsciously. These words of Jesus are the final words of every Christian. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. What do we really mean when we commit our spirit to the hands of God? My local rugby league club has a history book entitled The Spirit of the Red V. Now, when they use the word spirit, they are not referring to anything tangible, like the jersey, the ball, the players, club members, or the building for that matter. They are referring to something intangible, but undeniably identifiable. It exists and has power even though we can't see, touch, or feel it. It is the spirit of a person that connects them to God, shapes their character, and provides them with their unique qualities. It is the essence of life that transcends the mere existence of the physical body. Regular viewers will recall that I talked about developing an acute awareness of one's own spirit a few weeks ago. I believe this to be an issue that Christians should take seriously. Awareness of the body and mind is relatively straightforward, but awareness of the human spirit is more challenging and more complicated. It is here that we connect with God, for he is spirit, and it is in this place that we find him. God is spirit, and part of being made in his image means having a spirit. As we struggle to gain an awareness of our own spirit, we gain a richer understanding of Jesus' final words and their profound significance. There is a sense of a paradox here. In finding that inner awareness of our spirit, we have to surrender it to God to find it. In this quiet moment, still, before your throne, conscious of your presence, knowing I am known. In this quiet moment, set my spirit free. In this quiet moment, make a better me. As brutal and confronting as the crucifixion is, there are embedded truths in the words of Jesus that we need to not only understand, but integrate into our own lives. The reality is that we shrink from concentrating on graphic crucifixion scenes as they impact our sensibilities. I must confess that often, as I am looking for video clips and images, I often shy away from crucifixion scenes that are graphic or confronting for the simple reason I do not want to offend or distress my viewers. Yet the reality is that there is no pleasant way around the crucifixion. It was brutal, confronting and offensive in the extreme. And at some level, we must personally confront it if we are to comprehend in some way the cost of our sin. Jesus, keep me near the cross. There, a precious fountain, free to all, a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain.
Jesus, keep me near the cross.